Hello everyone. In this lecture, we are covering evidences of organ pollution, and we have covered some of the evidences in part 1. In second part, some of the evidences will be covered. So these are evidences from morphology and comparative anatomy. Connecting links. What are connecting links? Which connect two different forms. Yes, the animals which show the characteristics of two different groups. Either of two different classes or phylum, and they can be either living or missing, indicating that higher or group have evolved from the lower one through organic evolution are called connecting links. So what are connecting links? Basically, connecting links are the organisms or the animals from two different classes, or can be from two different phylum, or these can be living or missing. So this indicates that the higher organism or the more evolved organism have evolved from the lower one by the gradual process of organic evolution. So these are known as the connecting link between the two classes, or you can say between the two phyla. Such connecting links, they support organic evolution. Here is given the list of the connecting links organism. So Euglena, it is a connecting link between the animals and plants. Euglena, they have the mixotrophic mode of nutrition. Mixotrophic means both autotrophic and heterotrophic. So we know that plants are autotrophic, they make their own food. Animals are heterotrophic. So Euglena have the both mode of nutrition. So it is a connecting link between the animals and plants. Proterosporangia. It is between protozoa and porifera. Peripatus, very important. It is a connecting link between annelids and arthropod. Actually, the unjointed legs, nephridia, these are the annelidian characters, and presence of antennae and tracheal system for respiration, this is the arthropodian character. So peripatus has the characters of both arthropods and annelid, but basically it is a arthropod. Neopelion, this is a segmented mollusk, and it is a connecting link between annelid and mollusca. Balanoglossus, very important to know, it is a hemichordate actually, or non-chordate, and it is a connecting link between the non-chordate and chordates. Lungfishes, connecting link between fish and amphibians. Latimeria, fish and amphibians. Again, chimeria, cartilaginous and bony fishes, connecting link. Egg laying mammals shows the characters of both reptiles and mammals. So you have to remember this list. Archaeopteryx is a very known example of connecting links, or it is a missing link actually. Archaeopteryx was a bird, but now these are not present. These are the present as the missing link between the reptile and birds. Its fossil was formed by Wagner from limestone rocks of Jurassic period in Germany. The presence of teeth in this bird is a reptilian character. The teeth were present in the bird, but the feathers which were present in the Archaeopteryx, they shows the avian character or the birds, character of birds. So because of the presence of teeth and feather in Archaeopteryx, it forms a missing connecting link between reptile and birds. Vestibular organs which are present, but now present as a vestigial organs, no, nictitating membrane, auricular muscles in humans, chest hairs, nipples, segmental muscles, tail vertebrae in some newborn baby, tail can be seen, pyramidalis muscles, vermiform appendix and third molar in teeth. These are all the example of the vestigial organs. And vestigial organs which are of no use now, might be present in the earlier forms are also present in other animals, indicating the occurrence of organic evolution. Hind limbs and pelvic girdle in python, also an example of vestigial organ. Splint bones in horse, also an example of vestigial structures. White spot in frog's head, second and fifth toes in cattle, and wings in flightless birds. Wings are present, but they are of no use. So these are the example of the vestigial organs. Now atavism. This term, it is the phenomena of sudden appearance of ancestral characters which are not parental in young ones. The characters which are not parental, but sudden appearance of ancestral characters in any organism at the time of birth is the atavism. These are called as the atavistic structures. You might have come to know about the tail in the newly born babies. So it is a prominent example of atavism. Dense and long hair on body, appearance of long canines, presence of extra impulse in female, functional auricular muscles, because such character structure are ancestral and are not parental, they support organic evolution. Now the evidences from embryology. The comparative study of the embryology of different animal groups shows the structural similarities between them. So what is embryology? Actually, it is the study of the development from egg to hatching or birth. And this development biology covered the post-embryonic development also. So the evidences from the embryology also support the organic evolution. K. E. von Baer is known as the father of developmental biology or modern embryology. Von Baer gave the recapitulation theory, and it is also known as von Baer's law. He gave the statement, ontogeny repeats phylogeny. Very famous statement made by von Baer. He said that means an organism repeats its ancestral history during its development. Ontogeny means life history of an individual, animal, or phylogeny means is the evolutionary history of the race of the animal. So during the development of an organism always repeats its ancestral history. So here are the evidences from embryology. Occurrence of tadpole larva in embryonic development of frog. We are getting tadpole larva in frog's development. This indicates that frogs might have evolved from such ancestors. The tadpole has lateral line organ and internal gills covered with operculum. But these are the characters of the fishes. So this indicates that frog has evolved from such ancestors. The present of teeth in bird's embryo, and teeth are present in reptiles, so it is a reptilian characters. So presence of teeth in birds indicate that birds have evolved from the reptiles. So all modern birds are toothless, but all modern birds are toothless. So presence of teeth in birds is also a evidence from embryology. Fate of three germinal layer, all the organisms or the vertebrates, they have three germinal layer: ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. If the kidney is mesodermal in fishes and amphibian, and it is the same in mammals and reptile, so this shows that the evolutionary process, the history of the evolutionary process, development of vertebrate organs, development of many organs in vertebrates such as heart, brain and kidney point out a likely path of evolution in addition to the common ancestry of vertebrates. Also an example from embryology, many organs in vertebrate like heart, kidney, brain, they have the same evolutionary path as in many ancestors it's present. Now one of the example from the plant embryo. Protonema stage, as we know, you must have learned in class 11th in plant kingdom, in bryophytes the protonema stage is present. And this protonema stage is somehow is similar to the filamentous algal prothallus stage. Prothallus means the body is not differentiated into root, stem and leaf. It is present in the form of a thallus. So the bryophytes are advanced than the algae. Bryophytes. So this indication from algae to bryophytes and having this protonema stage, which is like a thallus, and algae are having the prothallus stage, this suggests the algae ancestry for bryophytes such as ferns. Okay. Now paleontological evidences. Paleontology, it is the study of fossil. And father of paleontobiology, paleontology is Leonora da Vinci. Modern paleobotany is Cuvier. The father of modern paleontology is Cuvier. What are fossils actually? Fossils are the remains or the in any form of the extinct organism buried in the past. The organism which were dead and they buried in the soil billion years ago, and now they are forms are available. So these are known as the fossils. Fossils are the remains in any form of the extinct organism buried in the past. And these fossils are found in sedimentary or stratified rocks. Very important to learn. Sometimes this is asked. The example of sedimentary rocks are sandstone, coal and limestone. So key points here are: fossils can be in the form of complete organism. Fossils can be the whole organism because of any casualty, because of earthquake or for any other reason. When buried in the soil as it is, then it is the fossil is present in the form of the complete organism. Like woolly mammoths which are found in Siberian. Fossils can be in the form of harder part like bones, teeth, exoskeleton, feather, collar or corals or shells. Statue like mineral bodies of extinct organisms are called molds. Molds, you have an idea. They are formed by replacement of decomposed organic matter by minerals. So this decomposition of the or formation of the replacement of the decomposed organic matter by minerals in order petrification. The fossils of weaker matter or rectal content are called coprolites. So these are the some key points which you have to remember. Coprolites, what are these? These are the fossils of the rectal content or the fecal matter. Molds, statue-like mineral bodies of the extinct organisms. Now dating of fossils. Fossils, from the fossils, the age of the organisms, or in the time period in which these organisms were present. So this help in the study of the evolution of the different kind of organism. So dating of fossils which are present in the rocks is done. One of the method is the radioactive methods. And in radioactive method, it is radioactive uranium method. It is potassium argon method. It is radioactive carbon method. So radioactive uranium method, we know that half-life period during which the half of the material is decayed is known as the half-life period of uranium is 4.5 billion years. Half-life period of uranium is 4.5 billion. And after eliminating alpha and beta particle, it changed into the stable lead, 206 PV lead. So by knowing the half-life of the uranium, or the time period in which it changes into stable lead, we can know about the age of the fossil. It can be used for dating the fossil or rock for more than 50 million years, which are more than 50 million years old. The age of those fossils can be done by this radioactive uranium method. Then another method is potassium argon method. Half-life period of this radioactive isotope is 1.3 billion years. This method has been used for dating the hominid fossils of Africa. After that, radioactive carbon method. Again, the half-life period of carbon is 5750 years, 5750 years. After eliminating beta particles, it changes into nitrogen N14. And by knowing the half-life, the age of the fossils, we up to the 105 years, 10 to the power 5 years, the age of the fossils can be known. Now, the fossil records of many animals are present nowadays, but the fossil record of horse is complete and best. These are the periods we will learn about these in the geological time scale, and these are the different forms of the horse. And now it is Eohippus, Mesohippus, Myohippus, Merihippus, Pleohippus and Eupus. These are present in the different periods of life: Eocene, Oligocene. It is also in Oligocene, Miocene, Pliocene, Pleistocene. And Eupus is the most advanced form of the horse. Evidences from physiology and biochemistry. The presence of same kind of enzyme or any pigment or any hereditary material or nucleic acid in all of the organism in most of the organism throughout the plant kingdom either or throughout the animal kingdom either shows or provide a prominent evidence from physiology and biochemistry. So here are given the few of the examples like trypsin, which is a proteolytic enzyme. It is present in all animal kingdom or throughout the animal kingdom. Pepsin, it is present in all the vertebrates. Rhodopsin, visual pigment, which is present in all higher vertebrates. DNA, hereditary material universally in most of the organisms. So the presence of same kind of enzymes, same kind of proteins, same kind of nucleic material in a particular class or a phylum or animal kingdom shows or are now present as evidence from physiology and biochemistry, and they all support the organic evolution of the life forms. Evidences from taxonomy and geographical distribution. Natural classification are based on homologous organ considering organic evolution. Phylogenetic trees given by Lamarck indicate the ancestry of modern organism. What is phylogeny? The phylogeny is like representing the ancestor at the top, then the descendant by means of branching out, then the descendant of these, then branching out, might be these are shifted to other location, then these. Then these are the kind of information present about the evolutionary process of an organism from the ancient form to the recent one in the form of a this pattern is known as the phylogenetic trees, and it was given by Lamarck, and this shows the ancestry of modern organism. Now also biochemical nomenclature, it is also based on natural interrelationship of the organism. So this is from taxonomy, the evidence and the distribution of organism. Like we have learned about the adaptive radiation, all these in the same in different habitats of the same geographical area, and evolution of the different life forms in Australia, marsupials, we have discussed in the earlier lecture. All these provide the evidences from taxonomy and geographical distribution. So here comes the end of the evidences for organic evolution. Thank you so much, guys.